They reached the same place, and they were not long there when the fearful lately beast stirred in the midst of the lot, and the hero slunk away as he did on yesterday, but it was not long after this when the man of the black horse came, with another dress on. No matter, she knew that it was the very same lad. "It is I am pleased to see you," said she. "I am in hopes you will handle your great sword today as you did yesterday. Come up and take breath." But they were not long there when they saw the beast steaming in the midst of the lock. At once he went to meet the beast, but there was Cooperstyke and Clapperstick, spluttering, splashing, raving, and roaring on the beast. They kept at it thus for a long time, and about the mouth of the night he cut another head off the beast. He put it on the knot and gave it to her. She gave him one of her earrings, and he leapt on the black horse, and he betook himself to the herding. The king's daughter went home with the heads. The general met her, and took the heads from her, and he said to her that she must tell that it was he who took the head off the beast this time also. "Who else took the head off the beast with you?" said she. They reached the king's house with the heads. Then there was joy and gladness. About the same time on the morrow, the two went away. The officer hid himself as he usually did. The king's daughter betook herself to the bank of the lock. The hero of the black horse came, and if roaring and raving were on the beast on the days that were past, this day it was horrible. But no matter, he took the third head off the beast, and drew it through the knot, and gave it to her. She gave him her other earring, and then she went home with the heads. When they reached the king's house, all were full of smiles, and the general was to marry the king's daughter the next day. The wedding was going on, and everyone about the castle longing till the priest should come. But when the priest came, she would marry only the one who could take the heads off the knot without cutting it. "Who should take the heads off the knot but the man that put the heads on?" said the king. The general tried them, but he could not lose them, and at last there was no one about the house but had tried to take the heads off the knot, but they could not. The king asked if there were anyone else about the house that would try to take the heads off the knot. They said that the herd had not tried them yet. Word went for the herd, and he was not long for moving them hither and thither. "But stop a bit, my lad," said the king's daughter. "The man that took the heads off the beast, he has my ring and my two earrings." The herd put his hand in his pocket, and he threw them on the board. "Thou art my man," said the king's daughter. The king was not so pleased when he saw that it was a herd who was to marry his daughter, but he ordered that he should be put in a better dress. But his daughter spoke, and she said that he had a dress as fine as any that ever was in his castle, and thus it happened. The herd put on the giant's golden dress, and they married that same day. They were now married, and everything went on well. But one day, and it was the namesake of the day when his father had promised him to the sea maiden, they were sauntering by the side of the loch, and lo and behold, she came and took him away to the loch without leave or asking. The king's daughter was now mournful, tearful, blind, sorrowful for her married man. She was always with her eye on the loch. An old soothsayer met her, and she told how it had befallen her married mate. Then he told her the thing to do to save her mate, and that she did. She took her harp to the seashore, and sat and played, and the sea maiden came up to listen, for sea maidens are fonder of music than all other creatures. But when the wife saw the sea maiden, she stopped. The sea maiden said, "Play on." But the princess said, "No, not till I see my man again." So the sea maiden put up his head out of the lock. Then the princess played again, and stopped till the sea maiden put him up to the waist. Then the princess played and stopped again, and this time the sea maiden put him all out of the lock, and he called on the falcon and became one and flew on shore. But the sea maiden took the princess, his wife. Sorrowful was each one that was in the town on this night. Her man was mournful, tearful, wandering down and up about the banks of the lock by day and night. The old soothsayer met him. The soothsayer told him that there was no way of killing the sea maiden but the one way, and this is it. In the island that is in the midst of the loch is the white-footed hind of the slenderest legs and the swiftest step, and though she be caught there will spring a hoodie out of her, and though the hoodie should be caught there will spring a trout out of her, but there is an egg in the mouth of the trout, and the soul of the sea maiden is in the egg, and if the egg breaks she is dead. Now, there was no way of getting to this island, for the sea maiden would sink each boat and raft that would go on the loch. He thought he would try to leave the strait with the black horse, and even so he did. The black horse left the strait. He saw the hind, and he led the black dog after her, but when he was on one side of the island, the hind would be on the other side. Oh, would the black dog and the carcass of flesh were near. No sooner spoke he the word than the grateful dog was at his side, and after the hind he went, and they were not long in bringing her to earth. But he no sooner caught her than a hoodie sprang out of her. Would that the falcon gray, of sharpest eye and swiftest wing were near. No sooner said he this than the falcon was after the hoodie, and she was not long putting her to earth, and as the hoodie fell on the bank of the loch, out of her jumps the trout. Oh, death thou art by me now, O otter. No sooner said than the otter was at his side, and out on the loch she leapt, and brings the trout from the midst of the loch, but no sooner pass, delivered to be my wife. In the wink of an eye, she was by his side. When he got hold of her hand in both his hands, he let his foot down on the egg and the sea maiden died. A legend of not many. Had Irish man, woman, or child has not heard of our renowned Hibernian Hercules, the great and glorious Finn McCool. Not one, from Cape Clear to the Giant's Causeway, nor from that back again to Cape Clear. And by the way, speaking of the Giant's Causeway brings me at once to the beginning of my story. Well, it so happened that Finn and his men were all working at the causeway in order to make a bridge across to Scotland, when Finn, who was very fond of his wife Hooding, took it into his head that he would go home and see how the poor woman got on in his absence. So, accordingly, he pulled up a fir tree, and after lopping off the roots and branches, made a walking stick of it, and set out on his way to Hooding. Hooding, or rather Finn, lived at this time on the very tip-top of Knockmany Hill, which faces a cousin of its own called Cullamore, that rises up half hill, half mountain, on the opposite side. There was at that time another giant named Coolin, some say he was Irish, and some say he was Scotch, but whether Scotch or Irish, sorrow doubt of it, but he was a Tartar. No other giant of the day could stand before him, and such was his strength that, when well vexed, he could give a scale that shook the country about him. The fame and name of him went far and near, and nothing in the shape of a man, it was said, had any chance with him in a fight. By one blow of his fists he flattened a thunderbolt and kept it in his pocket, in the shape of a pancake, to show to all his enemies when they were about to fight him. Undoubtedly, he had given every giant in Ireland a considerable beating, barring Finn McCool himself, and he swore that he would never rest night or day, winter or summer, till he would serve Finn with the same sauce, if he could catch him. However, the short and long of it was, with reverence be it spoken, that Finn heard Coolin was coming to the causeway to have a trial of strength with him, and he was seized with a very warm and sudden fit of affection for his wife, poor woman, leading a very lonely, uncomfortable life of it in his absence. He accordingly pulled up the fir tree, as I said before, and having stunted it into a walking stick, set out on his travels to see his darling Hooding on the top of Knockmany, by the way. In truth, the people wondered very much why it was that Finn selected such a windy spot for his dwelling house, and they even went so far as to tell him as much. "What can you mean, mister? You cool," said they, "by pitching your tent upon the top of Knockmany, where you never are without a breeze, day or night, winter or summer, and where you're often forced to take your nightcap without either going to bed or turning up your little finger, fine, and where, besides this, there's the Tsar's own want of water?" "Why," said Finn, "ever since I was the height of a round tower, I was known to be fond of having a good prospect of my own, and where the dickens, neighbors, could I find a better spot for a good prospect than the top of Knockmany? As for water, I am sinking a pump, and please goodness, as soon as the causeway's made, I intend to finish it." Now, this was more of Finn's philosophy, but the real state of the case was that he pitched upon the top of Knockmany in order that he might be able to see Coolin coming towards the house. All we have to say is that if he wanted a spot from which to keep a sharp lookout, and between ourselves, he didn't want it grievously, barring Steve Crew, or Steve Donnard, or its own cousin, Cullamore, he could not find a neater or more convenient situation for it in the sweet and sagacious province of Ulster. "God save all here," said Finn, good-humoredly, on putting his honest face into his own door. "Musha, Finn, a pig, and you're welcome home to your own new day, you darling.